It's great to be here. There's obviously lots of interest on this topic. In fact, both Dan and Josh mentioned this workshop, so I'm very happy to be here. My perspective is mostly from a deep learning researcher. I do like program induction. I have done some work, and I'll try to describe this in the next few minutes. So let's get started. We gave a tutorial, actually, at last NIPS, and we talked about program induction. It was a deep learning tutorial, but this is definitely one of the trendy topics. And in trying to categorize sort of what you could do with neural networks and program induction, we came up with three categories. I'm showing here only two, which are should be obvious to this audience, but let's just remind ourselves. The first one is the neural network is the program. So we have some sort of program specification, maybe given with some input-output examples, and then we try to feed a neural network such that given a new input, it will produce the correct answer. And then the second kind is one which a neural network generates code, which is program induction, I guess, and this code will obviously generalize well beyond the first type here of program induction that you can do with neural networks or machine learning in general. And so there's lots of work that I'm not going to obviously review here. There's been quite a few talks already talking about some of these and others. And I'm going to just give you sort of more of a personal trip or journey through this, right? So back in 2015, again, ancient times, we were sort of very excited by the capabilities of neural networks to process sequences, right? So we were literally applying sequence to sequence everywhere. And for those of you who don't know what sequence to sequence is, perhaps this is the only slide that hopefully conveys a bit of the idea. This is a paper which was after sequence to sequence was proposed, but which was essentially a modification to this idea that you could map from a sequence to a sequence with supervised learning. And in this work in particular, we tried to learn from examples. So we had pairs of given points and solutions. For instance, in here, we did try to find the traveling salesman problem solution to a set of endpoints. And this architecture, here symbolized as boxes, would be like differentiable sort of ways to induce complicated input-output mappings. And this particular one was able to sort of, given a set of input points, cover or like point at them in the right order so as to minimize the total length, for example. There's also some work that was going on as well from my friends, Ilya, Wojciech and Ilya. And what they were doing, and they did this slightly earlier and actually motivated my work that I just explained, they were just trying to map sort of small Python programs to their solution or output in that case, which was sort of the, let's say, the digits here of executing this. So this is the problem of the first kind, right? Like this, the neural network is the solution, provides sort of the mapping so that a new instance can be solved directly. Now, this is unpublished work, and this was done by an intern also back in 2015, John Gauthier. And what we were trying to do is say, okay, can we actually put Google as a sort of non-differentiable component in a chain of neural networks, sequence to sequence, and so on, and then try to bypass Google and approximate it with a neural network, so maybe linearizing or like approximating Google. Now, this wasn't published not because this is how Google runs today, disclaimer. We did not quite succeed, but that was kind of the vision that we were already trying to push forward back in 2015. And to make it a bit less challenging, because this would obviously take quite a bit of work for an intern, we went kind of back to Python programs, which were obviously studied, for instance, learning to execute in the same group. And to even more modestly, to just try to say, can we write a program that when we execute through the bash calculator, so we just echo the string and pipe it to BC, we'll provide an answer, right? So that was what we settled on, and this actually turned out to be quite challenging. This also was before we learned about reinforcement learning. So here, some things might sound familiar to RL, but we actually, our background was not in RL, so we didn't know much about that. So to concretize a bit, right? we will be given an input that will be something like at 3 and 3. Think of it as natural language, but we really just made it symbolic. We have an encoder network, a sequence-to-sequence model that will essentially rewrite these as to be put as the input to Bash calculator. And then we will get some answer out once we execute this program, and we'll just try to use a loss that will match exactly the answer. And we have two neural networks here, the encoder network, and then this approximate gradient network, which bypasses Bash calculator, so that we can then backprop through everything and just hope for the best with SGD as we usually do. And then we had another version, which actually was described a little bit in the previous talk, and also which was just kind of using reinforcement learning, although, as I said, we didn't know what reinforcement learning was too much at the time. But the idea was that this is back to type one, let's say, program induction, where the solution is given or is the output of the network, but then we need to evaluate the solution. And instead of using supervised learning, we're trying to sort of have a verifier that scores the solution, and we optimize for that. So, and that, there's a nice paper from Bello et al. Where they combined this idea of pointer networks with reinforcement learning that I recommend you read. So, long story short, we tried this, and it was very painful. The approximate gradient network did the following. You kind of can approximate quite well, actually, the sort of bypassing this Bash calculator, so you can understand how it maps vectors to vectors quite well. But then it tends to degenerate because you only maybe provide very boring outputs that yield an error, for instance. So then all the network needs to do is like output error all the time because your generator is issuing an invalid Bash calculator command. However, we actually managed to make it work to some extent, and this is the last slide of this section. Making it work to some extent did some annoying things in our view, which were, imagine the input was adding 90 plus 27. The neural network that encoded this to be input to the calculator actually, for some reason, changed the numbers. The result was still correct, but it did already some calculation. And of course, here, the main point is to make the calculation part of this problem and sort of rely on Bash calculator for that. And in earlier attempts, it even happened that the neural network would just provide the answer, and then Bash calculator would just get it through because it can apply the identity, essentially. Nonetheless, things kind of work to some extent, and it was definitely a fun project to do back in 3 years ago or so. So feed forward now to 2018, and it's kind of deep reinforcement learning, all the things. That's a lot of what I've been sort of thinking about in my current research these and past 2 years, since I moved from brain to DeepMind, which has like very strong algorithms for deep reinforcement learning at scale. And taking a look again at sort of these two paradigms, so let's remind ourselves, the neural network gets inputs and produces the output, or the neural network writes the program. We decided to attempt sort of a slightly less, maybe more, not less ambitious, but more sort of domain, a domain that we know a bit more about in neural networks, which is visual vision, right? So images. And if we are to map these two paradigms to vision, what we observe or what we can rewrite is, imagine I give you this scene here on the left, and I give you a viewpoint as well. So I'll say, well, given these coordinates, the scene looks like this. Given this other coordinate, the scene looks like that, and so on and so forth. You can try to learn a neural network that, given a new novel viewport, will output the correct sort of perspective with the lighting and so on that makes this correct. And in fact, there's a very nice paper by Ali Eslami that was published a month or so ago in Science that I recommend you read. It's essentially solving this with a very creative and nice neural network and on several domains. But here, what we were trying to do with our intern this summer, Yaroslav, and I'll give kind of a slightly different version of the talk he gave at this conference. What we were trying to do really was, well, given these viewports and the images, perhaps what we are more interested in understanding how this scene was formed. So there's a red sphere at this coordinate and a blue cube and at this coordinate and so on and so forth. So this was a paper presented here. There was an oral a few days ago that was actually in generative modeling, so maybe not quite the same audience as here. And what we were trying to do, as I was sort of suggesting, is to generate pixels, right? So generate an image, not in the traditional way that now we've come to see with, you know, adversarial networks, where there's a generator that's a neural network that outputs this matrix, which is interpreted as an image, but rather as a program, right? So I would really like, given something like this, and again, Josh and Brendan also like talked about this recently, right? So given these sort of input pixels, I would like to interpret this as really the program, the underlying process that generated this, not just generate all the pixels all at once. And there's obvious advantages to do image generation like this, including having the right inductive biases and not needing to learn from scratch absolutely everything that goes on in a complex, let's say, digit or 3D-dimensional scene. So just to give you a bit of a preview, right, that's kind of what our program or agent, in this case, generation algorithm was able to do. In here, I'm showing both Omniglot and these Celeb A faces and sort of the program as it's being executed in a painting program, much like if I ask any artist to use Photoshop or LibMyPaint, which is the library we use, to do a few strokes to try to generate precisely these images that were given as conditioning inputs, right? So the input was on the right here, and then the program sort of tries to find what are the strokes to write these accurately. So how did we do that? This is sort of the whole system. I'm gonna break it down for you. So we start from an agent. We, again, are applying deep reinforcement learning to a bunch of domains. So this agent obviously is able to perform some actions. And these actions are then fed to an environment which executes these actions, right? So the environment that we mostly studied was this LibMyPaint. This is a production sort of level program that happens to have an open source implementation so that you can actually interact it through an API programmatically, not through a UI like humans do, which is great. And we also consider Mujoco, which is more like this, to create these three-dimensional scenes. But of course, the program could be anything that has a lot of sort of built-in knowledge about graphics and you know, painting and simulating these nice droplets and so on. There's amazing programs out there waiting to be used by not only humans, but maybe by agents as well. Now, this agent, when it produces, or the policy, I'm using both interchangeably, when it produces the actions, these actions executed through the environment produce an image that looks something like this, right? It's not very precise, but it should look more like images as we train the policy. So what is the policy doing more precisely, right? So it starts from some blank canvas. So this is, by the way, an instance where we actually observe what's been painted as we sort of write this program, although we lifted that constraint in the paper as well, and it works a little bit as well. So then you have the agent that sort of observes the canvas and produces these strokes, which are parameterized as an action, like discrete action, what kind of color, the pressure, and all sorts of different values that you have to decide to produce this, this action, is fed to the renderer, and the renderer produces the canvas with the new action. Then the agent looks at it again, and it produces a new action, and so on and so forth, right? And this version, the first version I'm talking about, the agent is just trying to paint any image of a domain, right? It's not given a particular one that it wants to paint. This one is just kind of free-form painting, if you will, so long as the images look something like the thing we're trying to produce in the data set, in the training data set. So having said that, we need to still reward this agent for having done a good job at painting. And that is a bit tricky, right? Because we have this massive data set of Omniglot digits, and we have these agents sort of writing strokes first, obviously, randomly. So how do we reward it? And we just employ the kind of classic now method of when you don't know much how to propose a loss is to just say, well, my loss, or my reward in this case, is going to be trying to fool a critic, right? So to the critic, I'm going to give whatever this agent painted here generated at the bottom, and also a real data point from the distribution we're trying to paint. And the critic will try to classify which one is which, and the agent will try to fool this critic, right? So it will try to say, oh, like, I want you to be very confused. I want to paint things that you really think come from the data distribution. And a bit dissimilar to adversarial networks and critically is that these adversaries just provide a single scalar. This is the reward, the probability of the data generated being generated or real. But we don't backpropagate because we can't, right? We have this non-differentiable component in the middle. So the critic here is really only used to give a single scalar to the agent. We cannot backprop, although we could attempt to do what we did in the internship in 2015 to approximate this, but we haven't done this yet. So now the full picture should be clear. The policy is painting on this environment. Eventually, this environment produces an image, and only on the last produced image, we then consult a critic, and as long as we can fool this critic more and more, we're happy, we give reward to the policy, and we train this at scale, basically. And at scale, I mean that we use some sort of distributed system that was developed very recently at DeepMind, based on A to C. These are just technicalities of reinforcement learning, so it's not very important just to say that these are using sort of new developments in deep reinforcement learning. And we have both the agent that sort of receives these trajectories or these generations from itself, and then it feeds this reinforced style reward or loss function. And at the same time, these generated trajectories are sent to a discriminator learner that is trying to all the time tell apart the real and the fake. So this is sort of just a distributed setup of what would be a GAN plus an RL setup. And what's kind of interesting here is, obviously, we want to do inverse graphics. We don't want to generate just any digit. We want to generate a single digit that we give to the agent, or maybe a picture or a scene, and so on and so forth. So how to do that? Now, given that we are in vision, there are certain losses that might work well. I mean, L2 is pretty bad, but it's a start. We could attempt to do L2, at least it's somewhat smooth, unlike programs where it's either correct or incorrect. There's also many losses that people in computer vision have studied based on perceptual similarity. So you pre-train an image net model, and then you look at L2 distance at a higher level of abstraction. But all these actually failed. When we tried to condition the agent on a given image, it failed to produce something that minimized any of these distances that we gave it to. On the other hand, we just have demonstrated that with an adversarial setup, these laws actually made the agent learn to paint amnes digits, omniglot, or faces alike. So how do we modify this to now be able to give to the agent some image that's the one that we actually care about to paint, not any image from the distribution? And the change is actually quite simple. We simply concatenate to the critic. We give not only what's been generated, but we also give the intended to be painted image as extra input, right? So here, to the critic, instead of only giving the first column here, we give this one. And then for the agent to fake the critic or fool the critic, it better be the case that it generates something that is close to the intended picture here that we're trying to paint. So that's the main intuition. And something like this has been also proposed in the GAN literature. But this one change made the agent from getting stuck essentially in some sort of local optima to actually be able to progress and paint something that resembled the original that was given to it. And so the agent itself, all it sees now as an additional input is the target that it's trying to paint instead of just paint any target. And here, maybe to give a bit more intuition, if you think about L2 in image space, it might be very flat, and it might be the case that any action produced by the agent does not help on producing the desired RGB outputs, let's say. But on the other hand, discriminator might be providing a very nice curriculum, because if first, let's say, you decide, oh, I'm not going to paint anything, because why bother? Everything that I do is wrong. Then the discriminator will tell well, something is wrong or it's generated if it's blank. And then you're kind of pushed away from that mode. And by doing this sort of shaking a bit of the reward function, it turns out that it was very important. And this is what I mean. So I'm here plotting the L2 distance to the target on average on Omniglot and as training progresses. And the first, the dotted line that almost stays stuck at some sort of very bad reconstruction loss or L2 distance was trying to optimize L2 distance, right? So this is very unusual. We're trying to optimize L2. We are giving to the agent L2, yet the curve is not going down too much. It doesn't get too close to the target. Whereas discriminator, when we train these discriminators, actually it works really much better. Orders of magnitude, I mean, it's like the 1/4 of the loss here. And it actually manages to beat at its own sort of metric by minimizing or fooling this critic, which was pretty remarkable, I would say, to see this. So to see how all this work and putting everything together, we have, as we train, we have this agent that first paints some random strokes. And then as training progresses, this is unconditional. So we're trying to just paint MNIST digits, the classic machine learning sort of starting point. We get that the agent starts getting some statistics of the underlying digits that humans would paint. And eventually, it starts to get it, right? It starts to paint less in the center and so on and so forth, all to capture the statistics of the data. And eventually, things start looking like digits indeed. And at convergence, we can just sample. We can say to the agent, hey, write me a program or write me a set of a sequence of strokes. And if when we execute them, they look definitely like MNIST digits. So this was the sort of the first success of the model. And then, as I was discussing, we can also give a target digit that we want to paint. This, obviously, we don't know how the human painted this, right? So all these approaches that I described, there's no supervised data available, right? We don't know originally how the person in, like, whatever, the 90s painted these digits. But just by interacting with the environment, we actually managed to reconstruct reasonably all the digits that were given as the input in this case. So this is the conditional agent. And similarly for Omniglot, we sort of try to challenge a bit more challenging data set where there's more variability. And again, I'm showing here just generations of either unconditional or in this case, conditional. And then we also tried sort of other domains to test that the same approach, essentially the same code, let's say, when we change the environment, also works. So for instance, here, what we're doing is, instead of generating strokes, we sort of place objects in this sort of blank canvas that is three-dimensional in this case. And given an image like the following, we're going to try to write a small sequence of instructions to place, but also sometimes remove and change things. So the action space is combinatorial and quite large, even in this toy domain, to reproduce and get to the same image that we're giving as the input. And again, in this different, very different domain, but also very visual, of course, we also succeed to some extent to produce the right objects placed on the scene, which is very exciting to see. And also we compare to, let's say, if you just were to search over, you could search over like all your actions and say, find me the best scene such that I minimize L2 distance. That really struggles even when you iterate blocked MCMC for a while. Obviously, there are better techniques, but this was sort of to show that this, given a new scene, the set of actions is quite knowledgeable about what should be placed where. Of course, search could still enhance all this approach, but the point here is to just keep it simple for now. And then we lastly tested what many people also talked about today, which is generalization. This one is sort of a fun one where we just take the Omniglot model and we tried it on MNIST or whatever Yaroslav decided to paint in his free time during the internship. Also, we just try to do something more creative to take this kind of drawing on the left and apply again the Omniglot train example to these in a patch, you know, in a sort of grid or tiled version of it. We also played with robotics, and this is the one that's most exciting, right? Because if you can generate Omniglot, and you say, well, I want to paint Omniglot, I want to paint, you know, a picture, a painting of Omniglot with a robot, if you have actually a model that just paint pixel by pixel, this would create a huge mess. I mean, you cannot just make the robot paint pixel by pixel. Believe me, we have made a lot of mess in the robotics lab. On the other hand, now given a new digit, I can just produce this sequence of smooth instructions and feed them to the robot. And again, robotics is not solved, but with some pain, we got to it to paint sort of omniglot digits, which is quite nice. And then lastly, we took this CelebA model, and we actually applied to CIFAR-10, which is very different in distribution, right? So it didn't work all that well, but it's trying to painting the image, not really only like, knows a lot about faces, there's the central blob and so on. But here it kind of succeeded to some extent to paint this sheep or the whatever this animal is and the cars. So it does generalize to some extent, which is nice to see. And then to conclude my talk, I just wanted to sort of give some closing thoughts. So we're obviously very excited about this direction, and especially when not strictly doing program synthesis, but more like generating modalities, errors might be okay, right? This clearly does not reproduce in high fidelity the original, but it's a nice artistic interpretation. So going to music, more complex 3D scenes, or speech is something that excites us quite a bit. Obviously, we would also like to think about full-fledged program synthesis. I'm not sure the adversarial losses here apply immediately, but probably there are some creative ways to make this work as well for that particular problem. And I think as a community, we all kind of see that if we write a program, proving strong generalization is possible, whereas neural nets will always fail to generalize. I mean, they generalize to some extent, but it is obviously what they've been trained on is what they've been trained on. So I think this will motivate more and more research. It's super exciting times, I think. And lastly, as a kind of provoking thought, maybe, is this approach of reinforcement learning plus these adaptive laws that really gives you a sort of curriculum, is this a good path for perhaps solving these harder tasks that we're trying to do here? So with that, I'm thanking the audience for being here and waiting for lunch, and I am happy to take questions. Thank you. Cool. Any question? I have to see from here. Yeah. Oh, you're going to the mic. Great.
Yeah, thanks for the great talk.
Thanks.
I think the approach can be used for instance, drawing things or painting things, but we know that the natural scenes are not generated this way. This is not the way that physics work. So how do you think that this method can be applied on, for instance, natural scenes? Because I saw that you applied it on like CIFAR, but we know that this does not correspond to the causal or physical mechanisms behind the scenes. So how do you think the method could be applied in natural images?
Right, that's a great question. I think, so here, obviously, if you ask an artist to use Photoshop to faithfully paint something that's given to him, it's gonna succeed, even if not all the physics are understood. However, I think it is very exciting to think, okay, there are physics simulators, we have collections of sort of objects that are already come with the meshes, and we understand ray tracing and precise illumination and so on. All these can be simulated. So obviously what we're very excited about is, can we leverage all these that graphics people have built for us and you start utilizing the programs that precisely people use to generate essentially movies that we cannot distinguish from reality? I mean, that is the dream. It is far away, but totally. I mean, this is just the beginning for sure for us. Yep.
Hello. Can you please comment about how you're using this GAN loss to reinforce policy? Is this the case because your policy needs only like one scalar, like differential, and that's why your GAN loss works? But for example, if another context where you generate something with a generative model, not like reinforcement policy, can you still find a way to use GAN loss to distribute the gradient, you know, for the bigger domain?
Right. So the GAN loss here is used sort of in the most drastic way, because only at the end, after you've kind of committed to all the brushstrokes, you ask the critic, what's the probability of this being real? And then that probability is given as a reward. Now, obviously, you could be querying a critic as you paint, for instance. And these, whether it's a reinforcement learning agent or not, does not really matter. Like, it feels like some extra auxiliary losses would help. But this is kind of a more of a reinforcement learning question, right? If for instance, we trained a model that plays Go, should you try to always keep sort of a lead all the time as you play Go, or should you only care about at the end of the game to win or lose? And obviously, there are pros and cons to add more reward shaping, as it's called. Here, I think they're mostly pros because we can add more inductive biases. Now, the GAN loss indeed produces a single scalar, but there are other versions of similar ideas. For instance, you can trade the discriminator, and it produces a single scalar at the top, but it certainly produces other intermediate features which could also be used as a more like high-dimensional reward or even something you could backpropagate through. So there's definitely lots to be done. And by the way, I must say, using an adversary to give a reward to an agent is not novel from this work. We just use it in a very maybe novel way, but that, for instance, has been done for imitation learning, and there's all sorts of interesting works trying to combine these sort of two paradigms, and I think it's very promising. Yeah,
maybe. Thank you.
Yeah.